out there somewhere, alone and frightened.
When the HIV/AIDS scourge hit the country, the victims were not just the infected, but those close to them as well, like parents and children. Wilson Bugembe was not an exception at the prime of the first killer, as he lost both his parents untimely as a result of the disease at just 10 years of age. His has been a life of rags to riches, and a story anybody will be interested in knowing, for it's full of inspiration. Upon request, Wilson made time for us to film his life story. Welcome to Life Stories. Whatever the mind can conceive and believe, it can achieve. Today, Life Stories brings yet another inspiring story of a young gentleman who most of us see as an achiever. A pastor, a musician, but most of all, a soul breadwinner and guardian to many. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome with me, Pastor Wilson Bugembe.
Wow. I didn't know that was me.
That is you.
You were talking, man, yeah. I wish everyone knew that.
Most people know that.
I love the way you introduced me. You make it sound like a superstar, yeah. Yeah, but thank you, thank you. I'm glad to be here. I've always watched you on TV, and so thank you that finally you're at my door.
Thank you too. Yes. Thank you for accepting my request.
Amen.
Now, most of all, people know you as a pastor. They don't know your background. They don't know where you came from. They think you just came out of the blue and achieved whatever you have now. Mm. Who is Wilson Bugembe apart from the pastor?
I'm a product of God. I have so many mothers, so many fathers out there, so many friends. I lost my mom and my dad to AIDS. I've always told my story in my music and in my sermons.
Born in 1984, Wilson spent most of his early life in Masaka. It's until the death of his parents that he was later left in the custody of his grannies. After the passing on of both his parents, Wilson was yet to see more tragedies. Soon after, he did lose his two siblings.
We were a family made up of only boys. Okay. We were a happy family until when my mom passed on and my dad in 1994. And that's a long story. Since my mom died and my dad and most of my brothers were born HIV positive, we were five. Plus a stepbrother, his name is Frank. He's alive, he's a doctor somewhere in Masaka. And then three of them passed on with time. And Brian, who is my only brother now, biological brother. I got so many good brothers.
Okay.
Yeah, and he's done with university. You might see him around. He's always walking around.
Okay.
He's trying to start his life.
Today, Wilson is a pillar and idol to many. His story is one that truly inspires those that have met him or simply heard his music. And because in our new season, we intend to inspire and motivate hearts, we made a date with this now household musician and pastor to tell his life story. He then hosts us to his pastoral office in Nansana at Light the World Church for our first half of the interview. In his cozy office, your eyes meet the portraits of many of his life's idols and models.
I remember the love and the commitment of my dad.
Yeah.
He used to ride a bicycle. He was a very hardworking father. He was a singer in the Anglican Church. He had a very popular group by then called Hosanna. So many people from Masaka know Hosanna Choir.
Okay.
And my mom was the best mother. I remember when she was dying, I didn't know she was dying, but they took us in her room and she chased us away. She said, go, 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 go. And we were like, what? And like, I can't believe I'm going to die and miss my children. I don't want to look at you. Yeah. Same story with my dad. My dad, when he was passing on, he chased everybody out of his room and he wanted to talk to me alone. But I remember his words. I think that was a blessing of a father.
Mm.
Because fathers in Africa, we are like lions. You come and everyone,
yes.
But everyone takes off. But yeah, he told me I'm going to die. And then he told me, but I believe in you and I know you can make it. Take care of your brothers and love people. My dad loved people. His funeral had maybe above 5,000 plus people.
Wow.
He was a teacher in Masaka, and he was a writer of music, and he was in the Anglican Church. But one of the moments I'll never forget is those days nobody really believed there was HIV.
Hmm.
They believed it was witchcraft and
yes.
stuff like that. So yeah. I'll never forget that moment when my dad could sing on Sunday, and Ngayamba did those big gandula. And and then in the morning, Monday, we go see a witch doctor, you know.
Wow.
You know, yeah, and as a young
to
kid.
To heal him.
Yeah, as a young kid, I was like, come on, we went Sunday, we're in church.
In church,
and then,
yes.
And maybe that's the problem of being just religious and not being your heart really totally with Jesus. Because
yes.
he knew the truth, but he needed a solution. So it was one of the things that pushed me to seek Jesus a little more as a young kid.
How was your school life?
I went to so many schools. You know, when parents pass on, everyone will help you at a time, and
yes.
at some point they can't. So I went to Stella Maris, Masaka. My grandpa, who is still alive, I think it's the reason I can speak some good English. Maybe not good, but some English.
That's funny, some good English.
Yeah.
It's good. It's
Amen.
Clean
Thank
English.
You. Thank you. You don't want to blow your own trumpet,
yes,
right?
It's
yeah.
good.
So my grandfather took us home for some time, and he did what he did. And Stella Maris, then I went to so many schools in there, in between some schools somewhere in Misamvu, that's Masaka, Chibinge. Then I went to Gulama, that's where I was born, that's still Masaka.
Okay.
And then street life, and then for just a few weeks, months, then Good Samaritan picked me and took me to Highway College, Makerere. That's where I met Jesus.
In the custody of his loving grandparents, life was still not as appeasing, which later saw him make his way to the streets. How did you find yourself on the streets?
My grand was the best grandfather.
Was he your maternal or
paternal?
Okay.
He was helping almost the entire clan.
Mm.
Almost the entire clan. Now that I'm mature, I appreciate him and I thank God for him. Personally, I don't think I was a very good kid. Maybe I was very stubborn. And for some reason, if you mentioned anything, you told me to do this and do that, I would think you're talking to me like that because I don't have my mom, you know.
Oh, yes.
If my mom was here, you wouldn't have talked to me like
oh,
that.
Yes, yes.
So at some point, I had to run. I just got off.
You just decided to run because you felt you're not being loved. Enough.
Yeah, I felt not being loved. I felt like, but I know my grandfather loved me, but I was also not a very good kid. Now, way back, I used to be so angry and stuff, but over time, I've healed and I appreciate everything that my grandfather did for me. And I appreciate him for that.
Mm.
Yeah.
Does he still live? He's still
yeah,
alive?
He's still alive, and if he's watching, I love you so much, Jaja. Yeah.
How long were you there? How long were you on the streets?
It wasn't really a long time, between 3 to 12 weeks. You know, if you've never been on a street, you know, it was like forever, until one day I decided to take on my life. I went knocking on people's houses and offices. I ended up staying with a few friends on the street for weeks.
Mm.
But I never took drugs. I always called myself religious because my dad was so strong in the Anglican Church.
Mm.
And so I was like, yeah, we don't do some things.
Yes, you knew your limits.
Yeah, my limits. And.
Yes.
But even on the street, those kids took me on as their own kid still, because they would say, stay.
A few weeks into his new life, things were not any better, and a thought to take his life was almost achieved, if not for Good Samaritan's great will to adopt him. I would like to know, how hard was it for you living on the streets? Where were you sleeping? How were you feeding?
Bombo Road, there is a tree across, is it Maya Clinic or something?
It's Mayo Clinic.
Mayo Clinic. Actually, that tree is still there. It's a very huge tree. By then, it wasn't very huge.
Is it opposite YMCA?
No, that's too far. Close to Bible
Clinic.
Society.
Yes.
Bible Society. Then,
there's even a big, like, flowers. Is it
KCC? Yeah, something? Keep Kampala Clean, keep, something
exactly,
like that.
Yes.
Yeah. That's. I think Bible Society is, like, adjacent of,
yes,
that clinic is. So, across that road, that was my home.
I see a lot of street kids too.
Yes, they still live there.
Yes.
I call them OBs and OGs. Yes. I always wanted to go back to school. So for me, I always knocked on people's offices and cars, telling them, can you take me back to school?
Oh.
Can you take me back to school? Until one point, across that road, there was an office. I heard that those guys were Christians, they were locally, so I knocked in there. And they treated me so well. But when the pastor came in, he was not, I think he had had a bad day. So he's like, hey, who allowed this dirty boy to sit in my seat?
And, oh,
yeah. So I knelt down and I'm like, hey, I'm sorry, my mom is dead. My dad is dead. I want to go back to school. Can you help me? And I think he had had a very bad day. And he's like, I don't talk to street kids.
That is so sweet of you. You're trying to cover up for him. I think he had a bad day. No, if he's rude, he's rude.
Yeah, he was rude. He was mean. He was the turning point. You know, the Bible says that all things work together for good to those that love God.
Yes.
So he pushed me out. And he didn't push me. He was like, go, I don't talk to kids. I had this shirt which was yellow in color. So that was my nickname on the street. They used to call me Yellow. Yeah, Yellow. And that was my first song. Bambi tangalia yellow,
Bambi tangalia yellow, ya wede bari njapo, antike kasate kenari mina mugulamu. Gangenda kulima kaberamu, muna kune sanyu ke kakola vano kuchaka, na yellow kwensulamu.
That's the song that hit the charts in the Christian circles, yeah. So it was about my shirt that was yellow in color. So that day when that guy never gave me a shoulder to lean on, I thought, if a pastor cannot help,
can do this to me,
that nobody will.
Yes.
So that was my door being closed at me for good. And I went into that busy highway and I was running into the cars. Because I wanted a car to knock me down.
Oh no.
They brought me on the stage the next Sunday and I gave my story. And they said, do you want to give your life to Jesus? I said, no. Me and God, the power of me and Jesus, I was so angry.
Sano ulire katonda byakola
katonda byakola lero
sano ulire katonda byakola lero
katonda byakola
sano ulire katonda.
So that day when that guy never gave me a shoulder to lean on, I thought, if a pastor cannot help,
can do this to me,
that nobody will.
Yes.
So that was my door being closed at me for good. And I went into that busy highway and I was running into the cars because I wanted a car to knock me down.
Oh no.
So I can die. And of course no one wants to make an accident, right?
Yes.
So everyone was dodging me and
dodging
me. So besides that road was a guy called Patrick Semambo who came and he gave me a hug. And I cried so much, I wet his shirt with a lot of tears. And that hug saved my life. That's why up today, I believe it's not about money, it's about love.
Yes.
So he gave me a hug and he stopped a taxi. That's why I say God knew me. God knew me because he stopped a taxi and told the conductor to take me to a church. That church was called Trumpet Center by The pastor is Apostle John Mulinde, the guys who own the Sekuku Prayer Mountain for All Nations.
Mm.
That's the church. I met Pastor Michael Chimuli, I met Pastor Andrew, Pastor Rose, so many pastors. So this guy told me, when you go, he gave me a name, he wrote down, and he told me to look for Apostle John, and he says, but Apostle John is the senior pastor, he's going to be busy. So look for Pastor Michael Chimuli. And so I saw Pastor Michael, who is that guy right here?
That's Pastor Michael.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I saw him, and he was busy. Then he took me on to his wife and to Pastor Andrew. And his wife was kind enough. She took me at her house.
Took
me at her house. And he said, my husband is busy, but he might see you at home.
Mm.
So we waited. He came back. I was waiting. And he was super tired. But I told him my story. Remember, I was just crying every time I said my story out. And he said, okay, come on Sunday. So on Sunday, they got me on the stage, church pulpit, and I gave my story. And I was singing my songs that I wrote on the street about AIDS, AIDS, why are you killing us? God, what did you do to you? I was so angry. And that Sunday morning, I sang my street song at church. That church was opposite Crane Bank by then.
Mm.
And I'll never forget this conductor, that he's at Radio 1, he stopped, he got me by the hand and he ran with me. And then I'll never forget that moment when he said, that's the church, because Patrick had paid him, those are 200 shillings.
Okay.
By then, he paid him from Bombo Road to Radio 1 now, and then he took me behind Crane Bank where the church was.
Oh, yeah.
He said, that's the church, boy, that's the church. And then he took off. I'm like, okay. So I got down and started to, I'll never forget. I wish I could see that conductor.
Yes.
But he was my angel maybe.
Mm.
So they brought me to the stage the next Sunday and I gave my story. And they said, do you want to give your life to Jesus? I said, no. Me and God are parallel. Me and Jesus, I was so angry.
Because you thought God is the one who took your parents.
Everybody
and your brothers.
Is dying. Everything is not working out.
Yes.
Our house was, our home became a place for tears and agony and wailing. Every time we went to that, to my village, we were crying and burying people. I hated Mulago Hospital in Masaka, where almost every time we were bringing out bodies, aunties and uncles and whatever, and burying and funeral services, and I got tired. That's why I was like, if I ever get out of Masaka, I'll never go back.
Mm.
That was what was running in my mind. But now I love Masaka, that's my home. And I've gone back to tell them about Jesus.
At Trumpet Center, his new home, members of the congregation took young Wilson back to school. He, however, attributes part of his success to the UPE mode of education, for it nurtured him in many ways.
Mr. Stephen Mbogo, who was the director of Highway College and he was an elder in the church, him and his wife said, we'll take you back to school.
That's exactly what I wanted to ask you. Did you ever think about going back to school? Did you ever get a chance to go back?
There were so many opportunities at that church. It's a church that is in mission work. People are going all over the world and telling them about Jesus. It was exciting. I wanted the choir. And Prosy, the late wife to Mr. Mulinde, she loved me. And Sarah, Pastor Michael Chimuli's wife, they loved me. And Prosy told me, what do you want to do, Mom Prosy? And said, I want to learn piano. And then she gave me a very small keyboard and said, go with it to school. That Sunday, the church gave in an offering. They bought me my first mattress, they gave me everything.
That's the first, after the first testimony?
Yes.
Oh,
and then,
such a
but
blessing.
I didn't still give my life to Jesus.
To Jesus.
I was like, I just want to go back to school and help my brothers who are dying
in the
village.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, and I went to school. Mr. Stephen became my new dad. And at school, I was still a loner. I was always by myself, but I met a few friends.
Mm.
I met so many friends, but Philip, Wilfred, Ben, so many other guys. Those guys you found here.
Yes.
We met in school.
Yes.
And we were not Christians. But I went to school. They had this fellowship at school where Christians go and pray, Scripture Union. And I went there for wrong reasons. One, I went there because Mr. Stephen, who is my new dad, he said, I'll take you back to school. That day he shook his hand up in the audience and he said, I'll take you back to school as my son.
Oh.
And then he took me back to school. And I went to my grandma and I said, yeah.
We've made it.
School. Yeah, we went to Owino Market and we did shopping. The church gave in money. I was just crying.
Tears of joy. So which class were you joining then?
S2. Okay. S2, yeah, S2.
And which year was this?
Let's say 97, I was in P7. 98, yeah, 1999.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So that means you were on the streets for just almost a year?
Yeah, almost a year.
Okay.
Yeah. And I told President Museveni, because of UPE, that's why I was able to do P7.
Oh, that is sweet.
Yeah.
That is such a blessing.
I know most people don't like it, but I'm here to one of the guys that benefited
from UPE.
Yeah, so
yes, that's
so at school
good.
This fellowship, they were singing so much. I went in there for Stephen. He was a Christian and he was the owner of Highway College. So every time he found me in the fellowship, I was like, yeah, that's the way to go.
Yes.
And two, there was a beautiful girl. I wanted her to be my girlfriend. And she kept saying, keep coming. Yeah, until one day she said, did you come from the street? I'm like, who told you that? And then pointed at the guy, I almost killed that guy.
But,
I know. But I came from there.
Yes, especially someone I have a crush on.
Yeah.
I understand the feeling.
But at some point, the best day of my life is the day I walked down there.
Yes.
And I gave my life to Jesus Christ. I didn't want to go to hell because I knew the reality of death.
Yes.
I had seen people dying.
Yes.
And this preacher called Stephen Senfuma, he used to preach, Pastor Stephen, he used to preach about hell and heaven. And so many preachers from Full Gospel Church, because we were in Makerere, so many preachers. And for me, it was about hell and heaven. But today, things have changed. A pastor can preach about any other stuff, and they don't even talk about hell.
We'll go for a very short break, but when we come back, Pastor Wilson Bugembe will tell us the challenges he faced when he decided to become a pastor. Do not go away.
Money follows a dream, but a dream will never follow money.
Welcome back from the break. If you just joined us, we are with Pastor Wilson Bugembe. And before we went for the break, I promised you that he'll be telling us the challenges he's facing right now, or when he decided to become a pastor. As part of his journey, Bugembe started preaching early and worked hard in what he calls good news. The fruits would later be the birth of the now so popular Light the House World Church that is now home to many.
I wanted us to stick together and pray together, me and my friends. Mm. And I had visions when God is using me, filling stadiums, redeeming people, bringing Bebe Cool to church. Those are the dreams I used to have as a young boy. Not dreams as in dreaming, but vision.
Visions, yes.
Yeah, and I knew that I had a passion. But by then, you should know that I started as a preacher. And then I wrote music. And then if you are a singer, they saw you in a category of somebody who is, So then you're like, we are starting a church. And then that was my first challenge.
Yeah.
So many people said, if you're a singer, then sing. If you're a pastor, be a pastor. So many sermons were preached on people's pulpits. Now we hear Bugembe is now a pastor. You guys be careful, pride and stuff. And then some people were bored enough. They called me, so are you a pastor now? That was a very huge challenge.
Yes.
And I thought maybe I'm going to hit a rock. I'm going to hit a dead end.
Yeah.
But in my spirit, in my heart, I knew that I had this passion. I had, some vision. Sometimes how you know your vision is, sometimes you're like, fish in water and everybody looks at it and you thinks it's too cold down there.
Yes.
You're like, can I get you out?
Mm.
And when you bring it on the dry land, it will suffocate and
yes.
die. So when you are there, you feel this peace. So we came down here in Nansana. By then, even that was a mistake, moreover Nansana by then, and the mango tree. We didn't have any money and we were 9 students and I was 19.
19 years.
I was 19 years coming to 20.
Okay.
But very few people believed in me. And me and my team, we were too poor. We used to give an offering of 2,000 shillings.
That's something.
2,000, it could be big.
Yes, that's
yes.
something.
Amen.
Yes.
But our dream is this far and we didn't have any money. I didn't even, like, we had nothing, my sister, nothing.
Mm.
Because we didn't plan. Because today some people will do stuff as they plan. Let
yes.
me plan to start a church. Let me plan. We never had any plan. We just had passion. You don't need money. You need a
yes.
dream.
Yes.
Because money follows a dream, but a dream will never follow
money. Yes.
So we just had nothing on us. It rained on us. We were down in a valley. It shined on us. No, nothing. But then, also my age, you know, no married couples would feel comfortable for you to be their pastor and
yes.
give them counseling. And like, okay, yeah. So our church became a church of kids.
Oh.
Like big people would go, yeah, my kids love that church. Yes. And then we had so many people coming in for help because of my
yeah.
story.
Yeah.
My story was on radio and on TV. So many, we had like over 40, 50 orphans and street kids. Even those guys wouldn't come to our church. They'd go like, "Afet wasabi dele ku church yandala." So they'd call it.
Yes.
Yeah. But yeah, they were really, really, I remember there was this church I visited. By then there were the early days of, "Hey, uso naimba." Then I feed the kids at home. Because my heartbeat is children. I feed the kids and then nyimba to help me. And I remember I went to this church and they said, "Pastor Wilson is here." The entire choir went as in the entire choir. They laughed that I was called pastor.
Imagine.
And our people who used to come to our church, they could be, if you said you go to Light the Old Church, Pastor Mugembenga, they see you as, "Hey, seriously?"
Yes.
So he comes and he sings. And then, so your church.
That is so bad.
Yeah, our church was like an embarrassment if you said you go to that church.
Mm.
Just a few years down the road. Really, I faced it. I faced it hard, but we serve a mighty God.
Yes.
Who, you know, Bible Gamba. The Bible says when you go to a party, please take the back seat.
Yes.
Because you might take the front seat, and then someone more honorable than you comes, and then they ask you
to move.
To move, and then you will be ashamed.
Embarrassed.
And then it says, take the back seat. You never know. The host can come and see you in the back seat and say, "Hey, Suena, why are you here?"
Yes.
And then they will carry you in honor to a front
to
seat.
To the front seat.
So our church, even in our own area, was in the back seat.
Oh, yeah.
There is no church here. Jitute ulako, over generator, over... from all the way from Makerere to Wakiso.
Oh.
We were borrowing stuff. We have a meeting. We need a piano. All these pastors, actually, we are inviting all of them. The Batu Azika, and then eventually Azika at some point. We wanted to get this place where to preach from the pulpit, the podium, and it was 60,000 shillings. We spent 6 months trying to raise that money.
Wow.
Because everyone was a student, 9 students and a mango tree. They could give their money, and then after service they're like, "Pastor, I don't have transport." Now that this guy is like, "Munziri is a
sentence."
Yes. So here we are, 10 years down the road. Yeah, our church came from 9 students, from nothing. Towari pastor on our church was Kakova Nango, Ovachi. Now we are over, I think, on a weekend, we have 3 services and we are 5,000 members plus.
I've seen the church, it's huge. I had never been here. It's huge. It's such a blessing.
Amazing.
Yes.
People have built their church and we've come, like I said, God, He picked us from the front seat.
Yes.
I mean from the back seat.
From the back seat to the front seat.
And then it has had so many visions, like the Celebrity Sunday. Actually, I want to say thanks to NTV for airing Celebrity Sunday. The entire nation was watching Celebrity Sunday.
Yes.
We've had worship nights. Worship night is a night we do in the stadium. November, and it packs up. People come to worship all night long. We've had Mercy Child Care, me and my friends, most of those friends you see.
Okay.
We have over 190 kids.
Wow.
That are back to school. We are trying to build a village. I personally have 25, personally.
That's great.
And then together with the church, we have over 190 kids. And there's a guy called Wilfred who does that for us. And our impact for the church, you've seen even the prime ministers, even the princesses, even
I've seen the queen mother, the princess, so the president.
The church came from zero, from nothing. You know, we are impacting. We had what we call campus move. We got it from campus night, where they go and dance for free. So we send buses to all universities all over the country. Every year, campus move, and students love coming here. We had over 6,000 students, all the way from Guru, Kabale, Mbale. So we are impacting the church. Jesus is impacting the nation.
You know, that's such a blessing.
But this is a church that came from zero.
Yes.
Zero.
Yes.
And we've done many mistakes, and I keep telling people that suffering is part of the life package.
Yes.
And we've had our share. We've hit our challenges, so many challenges. But in God, you're never alone. He's always there. You know, God never promised you not to go through fire. But He said, I'll be there in fire time.
Yes, I'll be there to support you, to hold your hand.
In water, He never said you not go through water, but He said in water, I'll be there so you don't drown.
Oh, yes.
Yes. I've been criticized a lot for bringing celebrities to church and stuff like that.
But
now when you know my story, you know that for me, Katol Bwama said he's not been to church for 15 years.
Oh, okay.
The last time he was here. And that's why I'm here. That's why the church is here. The church, if you're a pastor who doesn't welcome people, then you are like a hospital that has everything in it. The doctors are there, the medicine, everything needed is there, but you chest the sick people. For me, if you were a sinner like me, and actually still a sinner, but every day we fall and rise by the grace, you should love. You should know why Jesus came. He came so He can save me. Jesus is like very soft on the cloth, very hard on the stain. That's Jesus.
Yes.
Very hard on sin, very soft on the sinner.
Okay, I'm going to take you back a little bit, very, very little. The challenges you've had when you're building up your church, what made you stick on your dream to persevere and push on to achieve what you have today?
So many reasons. First of all, we are not yet there. We don't want, I don't believe we should be in a church steering trees, though it's nice trees, but we believe to build a cathedral. We want to build a glass cathedral here.
Okay.
Our church is going to be made of 90% glass.
Wow.
Yeah, because we want it to attract the young people too, mainly young people. And we have a team. You know, when you are the head, you get the praises.
Yes.
But there is the stones in the foundation. There is the windows, but they keep saying, "Ena kunju yama batiaga blue baga good." But so I happen to get the praises as the team leader. But I have so many people watching on TV right now, all over the world, within the church and all over. Some give us prayer. So the reason I am here is not because I'm alone, but though I'm the one on the camera right now, But I'm just blessed to be the team leader of so many hardworking, good people. I think as you walked in, you saw all the way up.
All the way, everyone was welcoming us.
All the way
down,
there was people working.
Yes.
And two, I believed that you have to die for your dream. Before, I believe a bean seed should rot before it gets new, before it sprouts.
It germinates, yes.
Yeah, before it germinates. Mm. So if you don't want to rot, then you don't germinate.
Mm.
So at some point, you have to go through tough. Jesus had to go to the grave for 3 days before followers joined.
Mm.
So many followers. So sometimes we got to die for our dreams. And Nelson Mandela said, this dream I have, I'm willing to die for.
Mm.
So if there is anyone who believes he has a dream and you're not willing to die for it, sometimes we want the glory, we don't want the story.
Mm.
But why you're here, why you go around talking to these guys in glory, which I believe I'm not, but thank you for being here.
Yes.
But it is the story that holds the glory.
Yes.
So I believe that there is no fruits without roots. You need the roots, then you get the fruit.
Yes.
Yeah, so what kept me going? I believed I have to die for my dream before I germinate.
Okay.
Yeah.
Although Wilson has hit major milestones in his life, he cannot deny telling us that he has pressures from certain angles and directions in life. The pressure to get married is one that overwhelms him, as almost everybody that knows him has a question to it.
There's a rumor that whenever people come to church, especially the ladies,
yes,
they just come to admire you.
Mm.
And others even reach an extent of just crying when they see you. They just cry because everyone feels like you're their dream husband.
Mm.
Are you seeing anyone?
Okay. First, let's answer the rumor.
Okay.
I think I'm blessed so much that within the church, I don't see it. But it is those people that see it on TV and within...
But you've heard of that?
Yeah, I've heard so many people come to me say, you're my husband.
Sitani ya sindika, ya sindike gana liaba wala. Bulia kulaba ya gala kumuwasa, na kuzala ya gala kumuwasa. Not ya.
At first, I used to counsel them, no, I'm not. And then you realize some of them are so obsessed.
Yes.
Yeah, but if the devil wants to kill you soon, he should let you, convince you that you are the most handsome person, the greatest, and everyone thinks like so.
Yes.
So I know the truth. I know the truth that I am nothing, but God has made me what I am.
Mm.
And thank God for the story. Like I said, the story holds the glory. So many years ago, I tried to find girlfriends. Hey, Nkwagala. They could say, hey, Nyendo Nene, you have a big nose. They always had issues. So how come in an overnight I'm the most handsome guy? It is just, you know, the devil cannot kill you by killing you. He can just divert you. So I've had so many girls come, but thank God not from within. And recently I graduated in that. I know those are lustful people, and I'm sure you've had many people crush on you as well.
Yes.
Yeah. So you don't take it on. You know?
Yes.
You learn to not take it. Like I said, Sibiulira, Sibiulira. That's one of my songs.
Sibiulira, Sibiulira, Sibiulira. Biyungirira muno, bifulumira muno, Sibiulira.
Interestingly, he tells me on how he is seeing someone, in that when the time is right, they will make it official.
But I'm seeing someone.
Nice one. Mm.
To answer your question, I know most people think, hey, Wilson, I had recently a song, some guy saying, Wilson, at Limbe Mbaga, whichever. You know, if you're a people pleaser, you end up pleasing no one.
Yes.
If you want to please everyone,
mm,
you end up pleasing no one. If you
yes
want to please everyone, should be pleased. But I had a dream, and I had some goals set. At some point, the pressure was so much. It was so much from everywhere. Oh, what's a deal? And I was like, okay, I think I should.
Yeah.
But when you learn to control the pressure, have you ever been in a restaurant?
Mm-hmm.
Do you wonder why they play soft music in restaurants? Most times,
when is the food
people
coming?
React according to the tempo of the music.
Oh, nice one.
Yeah, most times. If the song is slow, then we're going to have good time,
yeah,
bring our thoughts together, and then we eat. you know, that kind of good melody. But if you go to a restaurant and they go kwa samba, that's the way people are going to eat. Before you know it,
you're choking.
Before you know it, you're going to finish your food in seconds because the song is quite. So sometimes, can you learn to hear the tempo so high?
Yeah.
But then you eat on normal speed.
Yes.
So that's life. People will pressurize you, but if you learn to control the tempo, the song is quasa, but I'm like quasa, and then like. Slowly.
Yes.
But I'm seeing someone, and I know I've been about for a long time. Even that song, Nangirira, where I said, Nangirira Mbaga Yechitiba, whereby everyone pinned me for that. Nangirira Mbaga Yechitiba, Pastor Ogeni. When I introduce my wife, I will let you know why I delay.
Wilson Bugembe has indeed achieved major milestones in his life. However, to most, he's their breathtaking and very creative master of music. Time and again, the sensational pastor as well as musician debuted his musical career with a song he dubbed Kasatika Yellow. He attributes his talent to his father, who was a musician in the church. So then I'm forced to ask how he generates his line for the lyrics.
How do you come up with such songs?
I think the writer of my music.
Okay.
Yeah, his name is the Holy Spirit.
Oh.
Yeah, I think
I was really listening, like, okay, who's
that? Yeah, he's a good writer.
Yes.
Yeah, he writes good music for me, and I sing it. So I think that's the way I think I love Jesus' way of doing proverbs, and then there is a hidden meaning.
Yes.
He was more of a philosopher.
Yes.
But I pray so much that they will understand it, because it's
around.
Yeah.
They do. That's why I even brought it up, because really appreciate it, and that's what people are always looking out for every time there's a song released.
Ani ayinza tula watula mukama. Sarapina Nakatumira jazzi kamukana Nentumane Filippo kamukana Nentumane sala kamukana Pangira kawalako
A few years ago, your church held a youth camp, and I think 4 kids drowned.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me about that. How did you feel when that happened, and the conclusions about what people were thinking about you?
Pastor Wilson's story is one we can only tell to the end in 2 episodes. So I will return next week to finish a story of hope and success, but also challenges.
Kani kwagala, 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 kani kwagala,
wenala byachuse nengende wawe nembuza tata we ono muwala yaba.